Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are in the world today. My name is Bonita Grange, your relationship and life coach. You're listening to Transforming Your Relationship on HGG Radio. We tune in here every Friday at 5:30 p.m. Mountain Standard Time. Always have some different topics that we have on the go. And for the last two or three times, we've been talking about relationship boundaries. Now, I never realized that there was so much when it comes to boundaries and relationship and the type of boundaries and how we feel about the boundaries and why do we allow people to overstep our boundaries. So the conversation is still starting, is still continuing, and we have some amazing individual with us. We have Jodi Ann, which is one of our regulars that comes on, and she'll tell you a little bit about herself for those that's listening for the first time. And then we have our new international speaker from Jamaica. She's very involved in marriage matters, along with both of these. Actually, Jody's one of the assistants that help out with marriage matters. So, Jodi, just tell us a little bit about yourself for the time that we have, and then I'll hand it over to Sharon for her to tell us, the audience, a little bit about herself. Go ahead. Who is Jodi?
Well, thank you very much for having me on the program, Bonito. My pleasure to be here today. A little bit about me. Basically, I from very early in life, I knew I was very interested in communication. I was very interested in relationships and relationship building. Mm. I read everything I could about love and marriage, etc. And when I became a little bit older, more mature, I started a course in pastoral and Christian counseling, a master's degree, which I'm yet to complete. Okay. But still along the same vein. In my other life, I'm also a pharmacist, a prescribing pharmacist, and youth director in church. And I love people. I love people. I love relationships, and anything that talks about bettering relationships has my ears. So again, my pleasure to be here.
All right. Well, thank you. Thank you for coming in again and making the time. All right, Sharon.
Hi, everyone. I am Sharon Prendergast. I have been involved with the Marriage Matters program. Mm-hmm. I do enjoy talking about marriage, relationships, you know, anything that can help us to get along better. In my other life, I'm a chartered governance professional and fellow of the International Compliance Association and also the Chartered Governance Institute UK and Ireland.
Okay.
I'm married to Pastor Fitzroy Prendergast and have two children. And as it relates to relationships, I've been married for 22 years. I still haven't quite figured it all out yet. I'm still learning on the job. Mm-hmm. And as I learn, I share.
Okay. I like what you said. You still haven't figured it out yet. Well, I'm going on 38 years and I'm still learning, sharing it.
15 and still haven't figured it out yet either.
my pastor would say, late pastor Bishop Simpson, he would say, it's not a destination, it's a journey. And so we continue to learn on this journey. So on the last, so thank you both for coming in and for even the wealth of information that you folks have locked up. So like yourself and like what I've been doing too, I just, when it comes about relationship, as you folks know, we can just go on and on about, because there's just so much to dive into. And also just being able to help individuals along the way with the experience that we have. So I thank God for the purpose that he has given to us, and we give him all the glory and all the praise for that. So we're going to continue on with relationship boundaries. I know in the last session that we had, we talked about how to stop feeling guilty about boundaries. Yvonne was on, and she mentioned the reason why also, which is I thought was pretty relevant, is that we feel, because we want to feel relevant, we allow our boundaries to be overridden sometimes. Because as you get older, you still want to feel important. You still want to be able to help individuals. But at the same time, we just have to be careful when it comes to that. So we want to continue a little bit on power imbalance. So I want both of you can chime in anytime. When it comes to relationship boundaries, how does power imbalance, where does that come in the picture?
Well,
anyone. I know Jody had started off last time, so you can go ahead, Jody, and Sharon can.
I think first of all, we should probably start with a definition for those who are not aware of what power imbalance is. Yeah, so power imbalance, you know, think about it. Think about a scale. Think about one side being tilted down more and the other one above. So there's no equality there. It's unbalanced, right? Mm-hmm. And so it's a situation of inequality, usually between parties. It could be between husband and wife, or it could be between employer, employee, pastor, congregant, etc., or you know, or parent and child. So it's any situation of inequality between parties that leaves one side relatively either unable to defend their own interests, or they don't feel empowered enough, or don't feel as if they have a voice, they're not on the same plane. So they feel somewhat disadvantaged.
Okay.
And vulnerable. Mm-hmm. So as it pertains to inequality, inequality in relationships, it can be huge, you know, because one party is left feeling vulnerable and you know, unempowered, basically. Mm-hmm. So they don't feel as if they have a voice at the table as it pertains to decision making. Mm-hmm. Or they feel as if they're not as relevant in the relationship.
Mm-hmm.
Or they feel as if it can cause them to feel devalued. It can cause one party to feel devalued, for sure.
Right.
Devalued, yes. I think I'll pause right there.
Oh, okay. There's so
much. Sharon will pick it up.
Go ahead.
Yeah.
You know, it's interesting as we talk about the impact of power dynamics on boundaries. Because from the one side, the person who has the greater power sometimes does not recognize that.
Okay.
And if you don't recognize that you're in a position of power, you will treat it, it's like a larger child playing with a smaller child. The bigger child has to recognize that they're bigger and stronger and can do more damage,
mm-hmm.
even in the same relative situation. So what you may express as a wish may feel like a command.
Mm.
And the other person may not feel as if they have the right or the option to say, I'm not comfortable with that.
Mm-hmm.
Just think of a situation where someone in power may yell at you.
Mm-hmm.
They are simply communicating their frustration.
Right.
But because you are not at the same level, you don't feel as if you have the right to yell back.
Mm-hmm.
You are equally frustrated, but you can't shout back.
Because.
And that creates a level of frustration that perhaps they had not intended. So when you're in a position of power, you have to recognize the power that you have.
Mm-hmm.
Your blows land harder, and you have to pull your punches in a conversation sometimes if you are in a position of power, so as not to hurt more than you intend to hurt.
Mm-hmm. I love the analogy of the bigger child and the smaller child, because I've noticed that too sometimes, even with my own children, you know, when they're playing with smaller children, you know, like I've had to say to my son in the past, because he was born a really big baby. So he was a big toddler. And sometimes when he's playing with the other children, and he just sees himself as a little kid, and he's just dropping on them, and he's just doing his thing, not realizing the impact of his weight, you know? So sometimes we are seemingly playing or having fun in the relationship, or just having that relationship and not realizing, as Sharon rightly said, the impact of our blows or the impact of our weight, because we don't realize that, you know, we don't necessarily see the power imbalance. Yeah.
You know, it's funny that sometimes we get to be bullies without recognizing.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes we have had to fight and struggle from a weaker position all our lives.
Mm-hmm.
And we keep that same attitude even when we're now the big guy.
Mm.
And then perhaps you may have had to struggle to be heard in your family home. So you learn to speak louder. You learn to speak more aggressively.
Mm-hmm.
You learn to shout in order to make yourself heard.
Mm-hmm.
And that was fine when you were 5'2" tall and standing up to people who were 6'4".
Right.
You're not a big guy.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
And the people around you smaller than you are, physically weaker than you are, mm-hmm. but you're still shouting as if you're trying to make yourself heard.
Mm.
That, without even meaning to, can violate their boundaries and make them feel as if they're simply incapable of standing up to you. So at each stage, I think it's important for us to assess the impact we're having on people and how our words fall.
Mm-hmm. I like what you said earlier about pulling your punches. So, you know, we're talking about this now, and mm-hmm. because of what we do, we're more aware of it. But how does one come to that awareness? What has to happen for them to actually come? Because some are actually destroying lives, and I could speak on that a little bit, especially when it comes to an individual. It could be a pastor or someone in high leadership position. And as Yvonne had mentioned, I believe on the last session that we had, she mentions about, you know, because of what we do as Christians, we have this mindset that we have to, we're always in a servant arena, so to speak, a servant mm-hmm. attitude. And then the boundaries sometimes get marred. But for an individual with that power imbalance, what has to take place for them to recognize what they're doing? That's what I'd want to know. That's that question.
I think it requires a sensitivity to the people around you. Mm-hmm. You have to be able to read the room. Mm-hmm. You know, even, I mean, in my other life, corporate governance is my thing. Mm-hmm. For example, one of the things we encourage chairpersons, don't offer your opinion first.
Mm. Okay.
You may have a casting vote. Hold on until the other persons in the room have expressed their opinion. Then you can express yours, because sometimes if you put your opinion first,
mm-hmm.
you shut down discussion and debate.
Okay.
Without meaning to.
Okay.
It's the same when you reassess your role. Perhaps you are now a husband and father. You are mm-hmm. no longer a kid in your parents' home. Mm-hmm. So the communication style now has to adjust to your new role. Look at the ways the people around you operate. Are they afraid to share their opinion? Do they always tell you yes?
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's a proverb that says, if two wise men always agree, there's no need for one of them. Are all the people around you saying yes?
Okay.
Your opinion can't be that great. What are you not hearing in the silences that you're ignoring? Is your family comfortable to raise a concern with you? Is your partner comfortable to say, hey, I don't want to eat Chinese today, I prefer Thai?
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Do they always agree with your suggestions? If your partner always, every single time, agrees with your suggestions, something is wrong.
Something is wrong.
Missing something.
Yeah.
So look at the way the people around you interact with you, and listen if you're hearing their authentic voice. Watch their face, watch their eyes. You know, learn to read their body language, and you'll know what they're not saying explicitly.
Mm-hmm.
You know, thought come to me about someone's always saying yes, even in a relationship, and you wonder, obviously we carry certain traits about us, and that usually didn't just happen yesterday. That evolved more than likely, possibly, when we're much younger. And we've learned to say yes throughout all our lives, even now when we get married. But you're saying yes for all this time, but at the end of the day and through the weeks and through the months and through the years, what is actually being pushed underneath the rug? Because there's going to be some kind of explosion, I would think, down the road. Because how long can you keep on going, always being empathetic with the person, always saying yes to the individual? So I like what you said here. I'm also sharing what I was getting out of that. You mentioned about sensitivity also.
Mm-hmm.
And with that also, I think for a person to also recognize that, I'm thinking that they have to be willing to be mentored also. We can't be that big, and we can't just know it all where somebody can't speak into your life. You know, I've had individuals that have allowed me to speak into their life. Because I've been married for X amount of years, I've been in management position. You know, we mature as we grow older. How we think at 68, we don't think like we do at 60. How we think at 60, we don't think at also at 50. So I really believe that being sensitive. But if you've never been sensitive all your life, how you've created sensitivity. Sharon, you got to help me. I've never been sensitive. I've always said what I wanted to. Joan, you can come. I've always spoke my own mind, and I've always had the upper hand, and nobody's ever actually challenged me. So what's this about sensitive? Why do I need to be sensitive?
Why? It's hard. And, you know, always having been in a dominant position, it's sometimes even hard to recognize that you do have the privilege of that position. Mm. You know, one of the things that I found very surprising as I grew older is that two people can be married to each other, but in two very different marriages. Mm-hmm. They experience the same marriage very differently.
Yes.
One person may be having a whale of a time because they always get what they want.
Right.
And another person may feel as if they're in a prison because they never get what they want. Mm-hmm. Same marriage. It started on the same day.
Same
two people, but it's two very different marriages. So sometimes we have to get clued in as to what type of marriage is your partner actually having. Mm. And it's not easy. Brother Bonito, you say, how does a person get clued in? If you have never been sensitive, if you have always been a hard hitter, if you have never had to pull your punches because you were always punching above your weight, mm-hmm. when you are now the heavyweight in the room, how do mm-hmm. you learn to pull your punches?
Yeah,
it's not easy, but I'm telling you that I think if you appreciate the harm that you can cause if you don't.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know, for those persons who may listen to Dr. Matty, several very useful YouTube videos, one of the things he pointed out is that many persons experience autoimmune issues because they violate their own boundaries. They don't defend their boundaries. Mm-hmm. And the same immune response, your immune response should say to an invading entity, hey, stop. Don't hurt me. Don't come in here.
Right.
But if you, in your social capacity, consistently don't defend yourself, your immune system will also learn that lesson and start attacking you.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Very interesting. Do you want the people around you to be sick of you? Literally, physically ill. If you say you love someone, do you want them to be literally, physically sick? Not blaming partners for their partner's sickness, but it can contribute. So understanding the harm that you can cause sometimes may be the first step mm-hmm. towards
recognize
learning that. To pull your punch.
Recognize, yeah. And as I mentioned, autoimmune there, you know, as I said, the immune system is supposed to basically attack and get rid of invaders. But then when somebody has an autoimmune disease, the body begins to see your own cells as the invaders, you know? Mm-hmm. And so you have an internal attack taking place. Mm-hmm. And if you don't get an immunosuppressant or something to calm down this response, mm-hmm. then you basically get eaten alive, as it were. You know, your body's destroying its own self. And so I guess in the same way we ourselves can get destroyed in our own relationships as individuals, as well as we can help to destroy the relationship itself. But on that note, as you're mentioning Sharon, you mentioned something about the power imbalance earlier. What came to my mind, and Brother Bonito, when you mentioned Yvonne from last week too, two right. things came to my mind, the power imbalance in church and the power imbalance sometimes in a relationship. And I know when it comes on to a marriage, this can get complicated because it's not always the man who has the upper hand. Sometimes it's a woman based on her financial mm-hmm. powers, you know, who has the mm-hmm. upper hand or seemingly has the upper hand in the relationship. A lot of dynamics there. But when we bring in the whole issue, if you're talking about Christians, Bible believing Christians, and you bring in the whole issue of submission, where does submission fall as it pertains to boundaries? Because if you're expected to be submissive, does that also mean that you have to not have boundaries or to violate your own boundaries in order to live up to the whole idea of being submissive, whether to your spouse or to your pastor? Mm-hmm. Where does submission, what role does submission play as it pertains to, if I'm being fully submissive, am I allowed to have boundaries?
Oh, now you open up a whole can of worms now there. It it's interesting. Sharon, what do you have to say about that? I mean, I've got something to say about that, but let me hear.
I definitely don't have the answer, but my perspective is that if someone is submitting to you, it places you in a position of where you have a greater duty of care to the person. Mm-hmm. You have to be even gentler. You have to be even more careful mm-hmm. when someone has submitted to you. Mm. So the submission to someone is not, to my mind, an opportunity for abuse. Mm-hmm. And it should never be used as an opportunity for abuse. To my mind, it should drive the person to be even more careful with the person. For example, if I have decided that we are going to invest together, and I take my life savings, Brother Bonito, and I hand them to you, I expect you to be extremely careful, perhaps more careful than you would be with your own money. Mm-hmm. I expect you to protect my interests.
Right.
I expect you to recognize that you have a duty of care.
Right.
Because I am a vulnerable person within your control to some extent. So I think it actually places more of a burden upon the person to whom submission is due. That they must be extremely careful. If I rest my confidence in you, if I invest my money, then my expectation of you is that you are going to be extremely careful. We see what happens when persons invest with other persons and they use their money frivolously. They're right. held to account. Mm-hmm. God mm-hmm. will hold you to account if someone places trust and reliance on you and you abuse that trust. When you're in a position of trust, I think it places a greater burden on you. If you're a parent and you're driving a car, you drive more carefully if your kid is in the back seat.
That's right. Okay. Analogy.
That's if right. you have someone else's money, you mm-hmm. check and you double check and you triple check just to be sure that you are handling it with care.
Right.
Because it has been entrusted to you. Mm-hmm. If I entrust my submission to you, I expect you to handle it with care to protect and to respect my dignity. If you fail to do that, you are going to be held seriously accountable.
Mm-hmm. And I think in the same way, as you mentioned, you know, entrusting and the care, I think the Bible did say he that findeth a wife, findeth a good thing and obtaineth favor from the Lord. Amen. So a wife is a good thing that has been entrusted into the care of her husband. And as much as God said, wives submit, he's saying husbands love. Love your wife to the degree to which Christ loved the church.
Right.
That you'd be even willing to give your life for her. Mm-hmm. So I have entrusted her to you. She's vulnerable now because she's in a position of submission to you, but you have the duty to care. That's what I'm kind of thinking, as you mentioned.
I mean, just imagine the day your parents, if you're lucky enough to have parents who can do that sort of thing, the day your parents give you a car, what would they think of you if they found that car filled with junk, the springs in the seat sprung, the steering wheel battered, you have used it carelessly, it's halfway down in some gully with the wheels twisted.
Abuse.
Come on. If a congregation has been entrusted to you, and you see, I think we have to always remember that this is being entrusted to care for something.
Right.
Submission is not something that you will force upon someone by an act of your will. And if you have to do that, there's a major red flag. You have been entrusted with something precious and valuable. Who has entrusted you with that? God.
Amen.
Who is, remember, he said to deal with your wives as fellow heirs of the grace of Christ. That's Jesus' daughter. She should be better off with you. If you have control over something, and I use the word control kind of loosely right there. I'm not into control.
Right.
But if you have been entrusted with something, it should be better off under your care than it would have been by itself. You can't make the person's life better. What are you doing with them? Leave them alone.
Amen.
You know,
you're not going into the relationship with the intent to enhance the person's life, to make them better off than they were before the day they met you.
That's
if they're going to be worse off after they've met you and been in your care,
then what?
Leave them alone. You're not ready for that.
Yes. Then you're not adding value.
Leave the person alone.
They're
better off by themselves. Leave them alone and go fix yourself.
You must have been one of my conversation here recently, because I was basically saying the same thing. Why would you want to get married to somebody to make their life miserable? Like, why would you want, is it just a matter of having somebody there that you can control? I mean, that's the only thing. Is it because you want to have control over that individual? But Jody, as you said, for a submissive, you know, when talk about power imbalance, it comes in play. It's more streamlined. Number one, remembering that we're Christians, we're a child of God. I'm a son of God. You're a daughter of God. But we first submit to one another first. So there's no big me. There's no little you. But at the same time, there's a headship that God has designed. And you know, as I was looking over some notes this morning, I'm thinking. So boundaries, like we don't talk about before we get married. We don't talk about. Well, many probably don't talk about respect. Don't talk about infidelity. Some maybe not talk about trust. We may not speak about honesty. Those are things that we would expect to be in a relationship without even coming up with it. But I guess this day and age, you've got to bring up a lot of different conversations around these areas, because you don't want to just walk into it blind. So I love the thought of power imbalance. I mean, there's so much more to go into that. So we only have about 4 minutes left. I wish we could continue on. We'll have to have another session next week. So Sharon, we'll have to get you to continue on with this, and maybe Yvonne will chime in. So listen, we're gonna have to cut off right now. I really appreciate the conversation. As one of my listeners says, like, why did you guys cut this thing off? We're just getting into it. It seems that way, but we only have a half an hour window, and as Ephesians 5 and 21 to 33, Jody's getting into that. We could go a little bit on that also, where the husband and the wife, and husband loving the wife and cherishing the wife and everything else, that there's no big me and no little. We got to realize that when you're married, we're on the same team. We're not fighting against one another. Mm-hmm. We're on the same team. So what's the best way that this team can move forward in harmony and love and empathy and compassion and so forth. So Sharon, I'm glad that we're glad to have you on today. Thank you so much.
I've enjoyed it.
Jamaica, she's a very busy lady, as you can hear from her profile in the beginning. So she's really made the time to be here with us here today. So thank you for that. And also Jody, another busy individual. So we thank you for that. So God bless you, and we will touch base again in the very near future. So stay tuned, folks, for next week on Relationship Boundaries. Mm-hmm.